So thanks again for coming to our webinar session, our monthly webinar session. The month of October is our focus is how to do change management. And really the focus is change management either within your organization, business processes, and of course since we specialize in PSA solutions like NetSuite OpenAir and FinancialForce PSA, we're going to be following up our webinar with two more sessions focused on each of those technologies over the next 2 weeks. So next Thursday, OpenAir will be focused, and then the 2 weeks from now, it'll be FinancialForce. Some other things that are happening with TopStep, if you happen to be out and about in these areas, we'd love to see you and have you join us. We are sponsoring or hosting a OpenAir user group in the Atlanta area on October 12th. It's a Wednesday. Our friends at TechStream Solutions have volunteered to let us use their facility. So if you're in the area, certainly sign up on our website and we'll see you there. And also if you're attending two conferences in a couple of weeks, one is the TSW conference, we're a sponsor, so we'd love to see you at the expo. And we are sponsoring for the first time the Institute of Management Consultants, IMC, and their conference, which is in the Washington, D.C. area. We're a gala sponsor, so definitely stop by if you plan on attending either of those events. And also an IMC, because we're a sponsor, they've given us a discount code. So if you do plan on attending or would like to attend, certainly reach out to us and we'll give you that discount code. So let's go on with the topic, which is change management. And really, you know, the definition of change management is managing change, as the term suggests. But it, in fact, it's really coordinating with people who are impacted by the change and making sure there's clear communication. And what I'm going to try and do in this short presentation is go through all of the aspects to consider when you are introducing change into an environment, specifically when it comes to also implementing like from a technology perspective, where there's a testing aspect to things. And this is all based on, you know, what we've run into, especially working with organizations and introducing new business processes with PSA solutions or implementing PSA solutions to begin with. And each of them has their challenges, but the areas that we run into that, you know, we have to consider are, you know, who's the audience that's going to be impacted by this change? Because those are the people that you want to make sure you're keeping in the loop, that you're communicating with, and that you're coordinating with to gather requirements and understand what's going to work best for the organization. Timeline, of course, is always a critical thing. Sometimes you're up against a deadline and you really have to kind of push things beyond what would be normally accepted. But for the most part, timeline is something that helps you keep things on pace. And throughout the timeline, you have checkpoints where you're communicating to people. And communication, to me, is one of the biggest things. How do we make sure that people are always in the loop and know what's going on? Okay. Implementation and testing, this aspect is really what change are you making? So the first three were all about coordination and information, right? But the implementation and testing is actually what you're changing. It could be a new business process. It could be a new system. But all of these things, when you come up with what it is that you're changing, you also should consider what do we need to verify is going to work, okay? And then what training and what support you'll need once you implement the change. So sending out like an email that says, hey, I just want to let everyone know that now you have to fill out form 95B in order to get approval to go to a training course. That's an easy change to communicate out to make sure that the form is correct. But you know, some changes include bigger training sessions. Hey, we're introducing a brand new project management system. Let's go through everything on how to create a project, how to manage a project, how to handle change orders, all those things. And some of you on the phone have gone through those training courses with us or helped to build those training courses even for your organization. And finally, support. So where do people go when they have questions? No matter how comprehensive your training, no matter how clear and comprehensive your communication is, there will always be a question that you haven't been able to answer or that maybe somebody missed something and they just need clarification. So you always need to have at least a place where people can go to find answers or someone to contact. So these are the six main aspects that we find and have to consider when we're doing working with customers to introduce change in their professional services environment. Now, the amount of each of these items and the approach that you take in each of these items really differs depending on what it is you're changing. I've mentioned a couple of examples already, things like introducing a new form to get approval for training or rolling out a PSA system. You can probably tell those two changes are very, very different from each other, and they have very, very different ways to handle the communication, the training, and the testing pieces of it, as you would expect. Now, from an audience identification perspective, so what I'm going to do in the slide deck is I'm going to go through each of these six aspects and kind of highlight pointers that we've learned over the life of, you know, our company and other jobs that we've held in the past, and sort of pass those on to you for consideration. So the audience that you have to identify, it's in project management terms, it's called key stakeholders often. But it really goes beyond key stakeholders to things like influencers and, you know, the end users that are just directly impacted. Rolling out a new expense report system and everyone in the company could be impacted. The key stakeholders are accounts payable that have to make sure that the system's going to meet their accounting needs. The influencers are people like managers and project managers who have to make sure that people are recording the information to the right projects and make it easy for them to be able to run reports, for example. So you should go through and identify who's impacted by the change and how are they impacted, and then who has to approve the change, because change should have some checks and balances in it, so that you're just not going in and randomly changing stuff, because just introducing something without coordination and sort of approvals from a management perspective does feel a little bit like chaos or uncontrolled environments. And that is true very much so for a PSA solution like a NetSuite Opener or FinancialForce PSA. Having an administrator just go and start changing things without communicating does feel like the system, the tool itself is broken when in fact somebody was impacting that change. Okay. And then, of course, who needs to be participating in implementing the change? Because those are the voices that are going to be heard throughout the organization. So find the voices that are advocates, find the voices that are influencers to the teams, and make sure that you've got those in your audience for coordination, communication, and adoption at the end of the day. Now the timeline can be quite tricky. In fact, we're recently working with a few customers, and you know, for most of us, it's Q4. Q4 is when everyone's trying to get ready for next year. So what can we hurry up and get in place or introduce or make changes to so that we start fresh in 2017, for example? So now we're up against the fact of, you know, there's just only 3 months left to the year, so you can't stop time. So timelines, you have to really consider a lot of things related to timelines when you implement change. Things like, are there any outages required for you to do the change? Like if you're implementing a new accounting system, do you have a parallel run of your old accounting system and your new accounting system and then do a cutover over a weekend, for example? Other things are if you're revamping the way that you're doing project management and you're implementing new task structures as templates, do you need to have any downtime so people are not in there putting time in the system when you need to freeze the baseline, so to speak? Okay. A lot of timelines we have to consider as a company working with customers on implementing systems like a PSA is that we always have to watch out for that dreaded month-end time period and quarter-end time period, because that's when everything and all the financial processing starts happening, and being able to coordinate and make change happen in the organization tends to be a risky time in a business, because the focus is we need to make sure our books are clean and projects are closed and invoices are out and revenue is booked correctly. So we tend to watch out for those types of windows. And then, of course, there's the inevitable holiday weeks like July 4th and Thanksgiving and the end of year with Christmas and everything. So avoiding any of those holiday time frames to be able to set the timeline up is always something to consider. Okay. Also, dependencies on organizations. There's been a few organizations we've worked with even that, you know, an entire department's off, you know, unavailable, and they are key to the rollout or key to the business change. So, therefore, you have to set your timeline up along with that. The tricky part of a timeline is the timeline does not dictate the effort. So if you have like a something that's going to take about 12 weeks to roll out, it really could take only 2 or 3 weeks worth of effort, but it takes 12 weeks to accomplish it because you need to coordinate, you need to deliver training courses, you need to follow up and measure adoption, and that 12 weeks is more of an adoption window than it is really an effort window. So timeline is very important to be able to get that timing right to get the approvals out. And then communication. So I've got a, communication is a big thing. You know, there's lots of ways to communicate nowadays, you know, with text messages and emails and, you know, Twitter and chatter and social media and in intranet information and message boards and all kinds of stuff. But communication is still an important thing in business because we need to make sure everyone is on the same page. And the more information you give people, the more that they can help you adopt the change in the organization and get the word out themselves. So I like to rely on the old presentation saying, as you can see the quote from Lewis Carroll, you know, tell them what you tell them, tell them, and then tell them what you told them, right? The whole, that's the presentation mantra. It's how do you make sure that people remember what it is you just said. But I like to, if we're working with PSA solutions, I like to make it, turn this into a little bit of a twist, actually, and build on that. Tell them what you're going to tell them, and then tell them what you told them, to change it into something like, tell them what's going to happen, when is it going to happen, and how does it benefit them. In business, being able to relate to the benefits of the end user tends to help people adopt change a little bit easier. Then you have to tell them when it's going to happen, like what, why, and what, and then tell them when. And then when it does happen, make sure you remind them, oh, by the way, it actually happened. You know, it's that inevitable timesheet go live. Always one of those big milestones when you're rolling out a PSA solution, but it's sort of anticlimactic because you're like, okay, everyone, log in and put your timesheet in, but the timesheet is for this week and today's Monday, and so people really haven't even worked yet today to put time in. But do tell them that they're it's available and they need to put it in and remind them of the benefit of the system. And then I like to make sure that people have an ability to give you feedback, whether it's direct feedback, whether you set up user forums, whether you set up some kind of Q&A, a website type thing for anonymous questions. Give people the ability to, well, complain, of course, but also to ask questions or make suggestions to make it better for the organization. The more input the individuals or the audience has, the more likely that they will adopt change, and they'll see that as a benefit to themselves. And then, of course, remind people periodically of what change has happened and why it's happened, especially if you're implementing a new process like resource scheduling. Resource scheduling is something that is very critical to an organization, but at the end of the day, getting invoices out and actual timesheets trumps scheduling for many customers. And there's still a very important aspect of resource scheduling and keeping up on that. So if you start falling behind, be able to remind people to get those schedules updated. Now, communication can be all kinds of forms, like your formal status meetings or steering committees. You can send like change management emails out saying, hey, you know, there's been a new release in the product. Here's the features that we've enabled. Here's how you use them. It could be dashboards or websites that you're sending out. In whatever format you choose, it's really what's going to be best for the organization to absorb the information, to be able to consume that message easily. Some companies, they're inundated with emails, so you sending out information in an email without, you know, a header that says, please read in capital letters, that email may get ignored. So if you have a message board that is something that's, you know, people log in, they hit their intranet, there's a message board with the latest update, maybe that's the best way in your organization. It really is organization specific. I tend to rely mostly on emails, but I realize that, you know, even in the world of working with email, that tends to get missed sometimes. So find creative ways to get that information out. Now, the other part of the communication I find that helps people sort of pay attention a bit more, people will look at status reports or they'll open up Word documents and they'll say, okay, yeah, that's status reports. But I find if you have some way to provide numbers are quickly consumable when people read status. Things like percentage budget burn or like a red, amber, green, are we on track type thing. Measures and metrics, I think, are important for rolling out change in an organization because it helps people understand if change is actually happening. Now, not every change can be measured, so to speak, but here's some examples of things that I think are able to be measured that can help you identify whether change is being adopted and to help the management team know whether change is being adopted and what else needs to happen as far as getting the community involved, the audience involved. So, for example, if you're rolling out like a PSA solution, understanding, okay, so at go live, everyone should log in and get your timesheets in. So, you know, for the next 2 weeks, what are you doing every day? You're measuring how many people have logged in and how many people have created their first timesheet. And that gives you an idea of how many people, first off, have heard the message, second off, are taking the action, and third, how many people you still need to follow up with and reach out to because something is getting missed in the communication. For other changes that are more training-oriented, like, hey, we're going to do something different, if there is a training webinar they have to listen to or something, maybe there's an opt-in measure you can do to say how many people have taken the training. That may not have some kind of numeric thing other than just taking the training course. And, of course, things like when you roll out a big process change where you have a data initiation or a data loading element, having people that are responsible for that data validate it, things like rolling out resource scheduling and loading all the initial schedules based on people's spreadsheets that they've been using. Have those resource managers, those department managers go in and validate that it matches what their spreadsheet had at handover. That shows you that there's participation by the organization. When you do establish these metrics, so set up a timeline, like how many days or how many weeks are you going to be measuring this and communicating that out so people can see sort of where we're at with the progress of adoption along the way, okay? And it's really important to continually emphasize, hey, we may not be our goal is everyone 100% timesheet login for the, you know, after the first week. And if they have any problems, who do they call? They can't figure out how to log in. They lock themselves out. They can't find the project they need. What's the communication method for them to get that answer? Now, implementation. Now, this is more specific to rolling out a brand new process or rolling out a brand new system. And specifically, it's, you know, these slides I have in my deck are for our PSA solution. So making a change happen in an environment like a tool, technology tool like a PSA, making the change could literally be as simple as checking a box and hitting save, and you're the person who happens to have permission to make that change happen. And sometimes a little tiny checkbox can have a big ripple effect because it, suddenly now something's required that people didn't know about, or, you know, they try to save a form and they can't, you know, complete the form because something else is being triggered that they don't have access to. So even a simple checkbox is something that really requires a bit of testing, I think. Simple does not imply no testing. Simple still means that there is a level of double-checking to make sure you've covered all your bases along the way. Of course, when you have more complicated changes like implementing a brand new integration with Salesforce or introducing a different way to do revenue recognition, those are all things that you'll want to have confidence with, that you have a whole set of requirements that you have to meet, and you will do formal testing. But at the end of the day, even a simple checkbox, you should do a couple of checks to make sure that behavior that you're expecting to happen, you have tested and verified, and you have enough information to be able to send out what change happened to the organization so that they know what to expect with the change. Okay. I truly believe all changes should be tested, and testing could be literally a two-minute double check to make sure if I create the timesheet, I no longer see the field that I needed to see, you know, or I didn't need to see anymore. Okay. And if it's something more like adopting a brand new PSA system, you may have a formal user acceptance test window with test scenarios that are representative of the organization and the way you do business, and that's a more involved test window. So it could be very small, it could be very large, but I truly believe everything should at least have some type of test to make sure it's working as expected. Now, if you do have a number of significant changes, most PSA solutions also offer up like a test environment or a sandbox environment where you can basically copy your production setup and configure and follow use cases in a sandbox or test environment without impacting production. In some cases, those sandboxes are additional cost. So occasionally, maybe production is an option for you testing, where you're basically setting up test projects inside production and giving everyone that's involved a heads up that you're creating this test project, that it's not something that should be processed by accounting. It's not just something that the PMs need to worry about scheduling people to. It's really your test environment. But that, doing any kind of testing in production, unless, again, it's very, very simple, does require a lot of coordination so that you're not inadvertently creating bad data in one system and then having it replicate in another system simply because people didn't realize it was test data. Now, for those of you who are more in the software development world or have been involved in software development, there is a traditional testing cycle from a waterfall perspective. If you do Agile, this is a little bit different than Agile methodology, where you basically have changes migrate through environments. So you have a change originating in one test environment that's sort of a try everything out type environment. You verify your concept works right, and then you basically replicate that change into a more stable baseline, like a quality assurance baseline where user acceptance testing may happen, QA testing may happen, and once that all passes all the checkboxes, then that gets moved into production. That's what I've experienced in my life with software development. And PSA solutions can also follow the same metric. The ease of moving between these environments is a little bit different based on the PSA solution you have. But it's not unheard of to have more than one sandbox or test environment to be able to play around in. The fifth area is this training. So training is how do people know what's happening and what do they know what it is they need to do. So when you want to make change happen, you have to make sure people are aware the change is happening and then how it impacts them. So, of course, the communication plan is your awareness factor. But the training plan is how do you get that knowledge over to the individual? How do I put a timesheet in? How do I log into the system? How do I update my resource schedule so that my forecast is correct? Some things in the format of the training is really dependent on the volume of material and the complexity of the material. So an email could be sufficient. But others could be, it could be a full-day classroom or two-day classroom with exercises where you have to spend time and ensure that people are actually adopting the change and understanding what the change is. The delivery methods, you know, with user guides, you could have your website have training. We have training on our website. All these webinars that we record, we post our website and help people take advantage of those for training purposes. But make sure that you have a place where everyone knows where the information is published, where there's user guides, where there's FAQs, where there's quick reference guides that you can look up to understand what it is you're supposed to be doing. And a nice little tip that I like to give customers is Timesheet training is one of those onboarding activities, but sometimes the onboarding doesn't get scheduled quite the way that you want, or people forget after they go to the onboarding training. So those PSA solutions that you're using where you're sending out that late timesheet alert, plop that on-demand webinar link right in that email and said, hey, by the way, your timesheet's late. If you've forgotten how to put a timesheet in, click here and watch this webinar. Really nice way to make sure that people know exactly where to go because they're getting notified at the same time. Okay. And then consider your audience. So if your audience is scattered across the four corners of the world, it's probably going to be a bit hard to do a real-life classroom environment. So adopt the material to be able to do a remote session, maybe a recorded session, and chunk it up into manageable segments so people are not listening to an eight-hour straight training video and falling asleep in the middle of it because it's just a lot of material to get through. Oh, and finally, empower users to deliver the training. So we love training. I love training. I love giving training to people and helping people understand what change is. But I find that adoption happens nicely by organizations that the person who's doing the training is really ends up being the go-to person to ask questions. And so we love helping customers in that aspect, but we also encourage customers to give their own training where possible because that drives a knowledge factor inside the organization, of course. And when it's all over, who's going to help? You know, who are you going to call, so to speak? So this is where you set up your support lines. You have your power user or your system administrator for their PSA or you're the owner of a process that is sort of the go-to person to help answer questions. There will be questions no matter how well you communicate and train, like I said. So one thing we like to make sure customers set up is make sure you have some type of help desk in place, whether it's just somebody's email address, or a dedicated, you know, distribution list or phone number, or integrate it with existing help desks. Your IT department may be able to pick up some of the work when it comes to PSA solutions or have some kind of business, like a PMO office, or I guess PMO already has office in it. PMO can be your, you know, help desk when it comes to process change. Set up user forums every now and then, you know, just have like a roundtable session. Say, hey, you know, we've been using the system for a couple of months now. We'd like to hear your feedback. What's working? What's not working? What do you like? What would you like to see different? Kind of thing. And that will give you a lot of, you know, a lot of good actions to review and show the organization that you're listening to their input, okay? Regular open line meetings is more of a real-time type thing, more for when you're rolling it out and getting feedback real-time, but also post rollout to get feedback. And then have a release management methodology. So especially if you're adopting technology, software solutions have releases. You know, almost all solutions that we're involved with have at least twice a year releases that introduce change into the environment. And how are you going to introduce that change into your environment, you know, once it's available, right? So have a methodology. And finally, actually have a governance plan on how to deal with the system, especially if you're working with multiple departments, multiple geographies, multiple offices, multiple companies even within your same solution or PSA solution, because a governance plan will help understand who's in charge, who should be coordinated with before a change is considered, implemented, and tested for adoption. This is where if you have too many chefs in the kitchen, too many cooks in the kitchen, you can create an inadvertent chaotic environment. So have that governance plan in place as part of your support plans going forward. So I'll open up the phone lines here in just a second, but really it's, you know, the change management, as you can see, there's a lot of communication involved in it. Always, I think testing is always a key value, key step in change management, making sure that you know what to expect, and then make sure people know where to go when there's questions that they may have.